So with that, I'm going to turn this over, our next slide here, to Jeffrey, and he's going to go over the actual results of our survey and share with you what we found in our responses and some of the other information.
Great. Thank you very much. Jeffrey Jaquette, assistant professor in sociology at South Dakota State University, and I want to recognize our PhD student, Michelle Kasu, who's sitting right next to me here, so in case I run into trouble on any of the data, since he did a lot of the data analysis, he can help out. And we're just going to mainly provide an overview of the data. There's a lot of data analysis that we would still like to do, and a lot of the sort of the details of the data analysis I don't think we really need to get into. So we did an online survey. It was administered through Question Pro online survey software, and it's basically a snowball sample technique where we gave out the URL to the survey and asked people to distribute that URL to their friends and colleagues as wide as possible on various listservs, on email, you know, correspondence, and so on. And so the advantage of that approach is that we can distribute the survey far and wide. I guess the disadvantage to that approach is that you're not quite sure how many people received the survey but maybe chose not to respond, or you're not quite sure how many people are sort of in the universe of manure management professionals out there. But we do know, so the people that we did receive surveys from, so we received 608 complete surveys, and then another 356 people who completed some or most of the questions. And so for the questions that they did complete, we can use that data, and for the questions that they didn't complete, then we just take them out of the survey. So overall, that's a fairly large number for an online survey. We were fairly pleased with that amount of responses. As far as the geographical distribution, the majority of our respondents were either from the Dakotas or from Pennsylvania, and that probably reflects those sort of the distribution method, the snowball distribution method, and folks in Pennsylvania did a particularly good job of getting that URL to their friends and colleagues, it looks like. Just in terms of we asked them sort of to indicate the organization that they work for, and we broke it up into a couple of categories. And by the largest group here was the university and or extension personnel, about 25% of our responses, and another 20% from government non-regulatory agency, and then another group from government regulatory agencies and news and media and tribal governments, and then the producers, which ended up being, I think, 80 or 90 responses from the producers, and we actually went back and tried to solicit more responses from the producers / operators, and we're able to get that many responses. We asked them sort of to self-report their level of knowledge. We didn't ask any test questions. We just basically asked, how knowledgeable are you on this issue? And then we asked them how important the issue is to their work. And you can see there that it tracked pretty closely, and that the majority of the people that responded to the survey said that it was either important or very important, and that they had at least some or a good deal of knowledge on the issue, and that the level of importance and the level of knowledge seemed to track closely together. So for this presentation, just want to focus on some of the results based on these big organization categories that had the most responses, the university extension, government, regulatory, non-regulatory, tribal government producers, and news media, and then just talk a little bit about some further analysis that we can do as we move forward. So we asked them about the resources of concern, and by far and away the largest, and this was a check all that apply question, and so by far and away the largest resource of concern was surface and groundwater, soil issues, crop issues. Air quality was a bit lower, societal impact was there, and climate change. And if you sort of look at those resources of concern by the organization type, it's fairly evenly distributed. You can see, you know, tribal governments was less concerned about the soil issues and the climate change for some reason. Producers were very concerned about the societal impact, relatively speaking, but less concerned about climate change. Some interesting results there. And then so this question, getting into these sort of information pathways in terms of what types of information is useful or relevant to the professionals. So this chart shows the different types of information sources. So we have field professional development, science-based sites or websites, consultation, technical documents, web settings, research papers, classroom settings, press and media, decision tools, and social media. And then so the colorful bars show the different organizational categories. And you can see that sort of relatively consistent across the different organizational groups that, you know, sort of field experiences was the most relevant across most of them, followed by sort of this professional development, science-based websites, consultation, and that the sort of the least relevant on the other end of the scale was social media, followed by decision tools, followed by sort of the popular press and traditional media. And classroom settings, research papers, settings were in the middle of the pack there. If you look at the data a little differently, so amongst the university and extension, you can see that the field-based experiences were the most relevant, followed closely by professional development, press and media, and so on. And sort of see the range here, and that even amongst the social media was the least relevant, but still more relevant than any of these other categories of organization type. Even for people in the news media, you know, social media and news media were amongst the least relevant sources of information for them. One thing that's interesting for producers, they identified consultation as being the most relevant. So these different types of information sources can be sort of reduced further. We ran a factor analysis to determine what types of information sources seem to be answered in a similar manner. And so those sort of broke into three categories where these different types of information sources tended to track closely together in how people found them relevant or not relevant. And we sort of categorized these into a group setting, a technical group setting, in a more individual technical setting, and then a sort of a non-technical setting. And the way people answered whether these were relevant or non-relevant seemed to be fairly similar according to the statistical analysis. And you can see that the group setting, the group technical setting, and the technical setting, individual technical setting, tended to be way more relevant than the sort of non-technical sources of information. And even across all the different categories, we asked the same group of folks on what are the barriers to using these types of information sources. And one thing that jumped out at us is that most of the types of barriers, most of the types of information sources, the respondents indicated that there were no barriers to use. For example, science-based websites, most people indicated there was no barrier to use. Same thing with technical documents, there was no barrier. But then if you take the no barriers away and just look at what they identified as barriers, there's some differences. You can see that for a lot of these, the green is high time commitment, and that the time commitment was a fairly large barrier for a lot of these for a number of people, whereas the sort of the non-technical sources of information, time commitment was not as much of an issue. However, low source credibility was an issue for those. and professional developments had a high cost associated with it, and so on. So we then asked a similar suite of questions. However, we asked them, what types of information sources do you use to disseminate information? So what types of tools do you use to put information that you produce out into the world? So slightly different information, slightly different responses here. For, again, the field-based experiences, consultation and professional development tended to be the most relevant types of information dissemination. However, as you can see, there's a little bit more of a discrepancy in how people responded to these types of information dissemination. If you look at the data broken up by organization type, you can see for university extension folks, field-based experiences, the consultations, the professional developments, the science-based websites were all very relevant sources. For producers, consultation was the most relevant, perhaps unsurprisingly, followed by field-based experience. And as before, social media and press and media tended to be the least relevant, and the decision-making tool tended to be the least relevant sources of dissemination. To do the factor analysis for dissemination types, it actually only was factored into two different categories, which we considered the technical setting and then the non-technical media setting. And those responses tended to track fairly similarly together. And again, the technical information tended to be more relevant with this audience than the non-technical. And similar, when we asked them about barriers to using these types of information for dissemination, the biggest category was that there were no barriers for a lot of these. So does that, still a bit unclear, does that mean that these, our respondents are using them then, if there's no barriers? Or if there's no barriers to use, but they're not using them, then there must be some other barrier to use that perhaps wasn't identified on the survey. If you remove the no barriers to use, whoops, I guess we don't have that one for this presentation. But there's, if you remove the no barriers to use, there's sort of some differences that come out. The social media, traditional media, tended to be not relevant to my audience was a listing. The high time commitment for classroom settings for professional development was indicated. And then the sort of the final category of data that we looked at was whether people found collaboration with the other organizational types to be relevant or not relevant to their work. And again, fairly consistent that the sort of the most relevant collaboration across all the different categories was producer, which makes sense, and we thought that was interesting. But if you look at the producer category, which is the blue bar there, everyone thought that collaboration with producers was very relevant. However, producers didn't find that collaboration with the other categories necessarily were as relevant. They found, you know, collaboration with public service, sales and private enterprise, news and media to be much less relevant than, say, collaboration with university extension or other producers, federal agencies, and so on. Barriers to collaboration between these groups. Again, the biggest category was no barriers to use. However, some other, you know, barriers identified not relevant to my job, or they do not have a relationship with those organization types, and we're sort of unclear if they would like to have a relationship and they just don't have one, or is it something they just don't need to have a relationship and they don't have one, so therefore that's the biggest barrier to collaboration. And so just a couple of survey observations in terms of this data. The decision tools seem to, which, you know, extension agents have spent a lot of time developing decision tools over the last couple decades, and you know, people seem to lump those in with social media and the news and the sort of traditional news in terms of how they view those in terms of relevant for either dissemination or for gathering information. And so it's sort of unclear whether they understood what decision tools were, or they perhaps it was a poorly worded survey question, or in fact, they just really don't find decision tools relevant, could be another possibility. And that the so the difference in the focus by organizations there, without getting into the more statistical details, there were some statistically significant differences between these organizations on some of the information sources, but then on other information sources, there weren't exactly differences in the relevance. And I know Jill's gonna demonstrate sort of a way to visualize those differences in a minute, which really sort of demonstrates how this information can be useful to people in this industry. And then state and regional differences. This is an area that we need to do a little bit more analysis on. We did see some differences in information sources based on region, just mainly comparing the North Central region to the rest of the country. And differences in the resources of concern, or regional differences as well. So we have some more data yet to analyze. However, there's definitely some interesting observations emerging from what we have.